This is the Detroit Sports Podcast Network.
The biggest icon in podcasting.
Welcome in, everybody, to another episode of the Doc and Jock Wrestling Podcast. This is episode 181. On today's show, the Doc's going to be doing this one live from the studio. I'm going to be doing this from the palatial estate of Deborah Dombrowski. That's my mother, out here in Oxford visiting her. I didn't get to visit her on Mother's Day. This is the post-Mother's Day edition of the Doc and Jock Wrestling Podcast. In today's episode, WWE is bringing back this former wrestler, as well as an AEW star dealing with some monstrous injuries and could be sidelining him for a while. Also, infighting with some of the AEW EVPs. We've got all of that in the news and notes. Of course, we've got, what are they calling this? The Wrestle Backlash pay-per-view. We've got the preview of that. I'm going to tell you what AEW does better than anybody else. Of course, we're going to take a look at the biggest topics and trends in wrestling. And like I had mentioned before, he's the one who does it with me every single week. He is the one. He is the only. He is the Doc, John Macaroon. What's up, cuz?
I am known as the EVP with all the love and class, baby. No one's going to argue with me. That's why the Detroit Sports Podcast Network has been around for damn near 8 years. Infighting after less than 2 years? I can't wait to hear about it. I mean, when you got big egos, I could see some clashes and maybe the direction. Maybe people have different visions of where things need to go. But AEW seemingly moving forward, but some infighting. I like it. You know, probably if we really wanted to dig deep, we could find infighting at every single wrestling company because there is so much to take a look at in terms of merchandise, television programming, talent, pushes, who should be up the card, who should be lower in the card, when, titles. Oh my gosh, I can't wait for the AEW book to come out and the anonymous sources come in and be like, Kenny Omega really hated Cody and the whole stupid promos that he had to run and him featuring his pregnant wife all the time. I can't wait for the real dish to come out.
Yeah, it doesn't really surprise me because when it comes down to it, right, you've got, like you said, all these monstrous egos, all these people with checks on the line, dollar amounts, and what it means to their bottom line. All of that stuff's impacted. So when these guys start kind of going back and forth, and when you've got some of the best in the game basically trying to run a company together, things are going to happen. There's going to be some bruised egos. Feelings are going to get hurt. So it doesn't really surprise me. But let's start with Monday Night Raw. And on Monday Night Raw, one of your favorite wrestlers returned. Jinder Mahal came back. And Jinder Mahal squashed Jeff Hardy. And after Monday Night Raw, it was called Raw Talk. Jinder Mahal had a couple of his buddies with him. It seems like he's getting his own faction again. I want to know, do you think this time around, Jinder Mahal, after an extended period of time off television and back with a new group of guys, do you think this one goes better than the last time he had a faction?
Man, I didn't realize because I went back and looked. It was a pleasant surprise because you hadn't really heard any lead up to it. So it was nice to see. They gave him a promo. It was great. He's only 34 years old. He can definitely, you know, he upgraded. He went from the two little guys to the two big guys. And it made a lot more sense, more believable. And he just looked more comfortable. But unfortunately, it's the same gimmick. It's, I'm Jinder Mahal and I want to be the champ. You know, they needed maybe a female in the mix, you know, two big dudes and a female rounds out the faction that can talk for him. But being that this is Jinder Mahal, I expect if you're looking for a new opponent, maybe around the Survivor Series for Bobby Lashley, those two behemoths can absolutely tear the house down. But no, Jinder Mahal does not deserve a title win at this point in time. He needs to be in the mix, in the hunt for the next few months, just because of the fact that and in the back of everyone's minds, everyone has to believe and wonder, can he stay healthy? Because they're not in the business of keeping the opportunities alive 6 and 7 and 8 times if the guy is going to be out for a year at a time with both knees getting shot. So let's hope he has a nice 4 or 5 year run and he can actually live up to the hype. But it was great to hear his music. Great to see him going through the curtain there. Jinder Mahal's back, baby. The modern day Maharaja is back, baby. And it was great. It made Raw a little bit more tolerable than in weeks past.
I like when you say it. I think they should hire you to be the to be his personal ring announcement.
Oh, I would say so, it too. I'd be like, even though you all believe it, he's not juicing, baby. This is all lean protein from the great country of wherever the hell he's from. Because everyone's thinking it and everybody's talking about it. Dude's found the needle, huh? He's found the fresh needle.
Oh, found it for sure. he's got the good stuff.
The fountain of strength.
Him and Braun Strowman, I'm pretty sure.
The fountain of strength is keeping this guy strong, man. Wow.
What'd you make of the Eva Marie promos? This is the second week we've got introduced to Eva Marie again. And look, as I was watching this, it felt so much like it was trying to be a forced Attitude Era type of promo, right? Like a little bit over sexualized. She's talking about how she's back because she wants to be back. Like, no, you're back because you couldn't make it as your Instagram celebrity. I'm like, you weren't good in the ring before. You're not going to be good again because I don't think you put the time or the effort. And I don't think you love this business. And I don't think you care enough to do this. But this seems like such a Vince McMahon creation because she's a good looking girl. She's got sex appeal. If you produce her right, she can sell, but she needs to be produced. And when you get in the ring, you can't really be produced. And I think that's where she always falls short. What did you make of all this?
Yeah, it was disappointing because I'm not looking for it. Nobody's really looking for it. And I mean, the promos are great. They're well done, but she can't wrestle. And she's now in her late 30s. I was like, man, time flies in regards to her run in WWE. It's going to fall flat, eventually speaking. She'll end up being a commentator or an interviewer. I don't see this going well at all. And I think a lot of people, if you look at some of the responses when it's posted on social media, they're just laughing at it because she doesn't have credibility. And now with the revolution going on, it's about the wrestling. And yeah, I understand ratings and things like that. Let's see if she draws. But if she doesn't, you're going to be a worse version of Lana. And you can't have that. Hopefully she did the work in the ring in the last year. And maybe she'll surprise people with some clean matches. But nobody's expecting it.
What did you make of this entire Monday Night Raw? This is a go-home show for the big pay-per-view after WrestleMania. So you would think that they would try to put something together to really help sell this. Like, there's nothing from Monday Night Raw that really has me like, I'm intrigued. I really want to watch this. Not even the Bobby Lashley, Braun Strowman, Drew McIntyre. And like, I love Drew McIntyre, but like, not even that has me gripped and makes me want to be like, oh yeah, we should really check this out. To me, again, it just felt like WWE missed on a go home show.
See, I look at it differently in that the biggest draw got the most attention. So it kind of built up to it, meaning that you get a little bit of Charlotte, you get a little bit of the women's action, you get a little bit of RK-Bro, and obviously
RK-Bro has like been the best thing on Monday Night Raw the last 3 weeks.
You saw the match between Shelton Benjamin and, you know, to see the breakup there of the Hurt Business, it was a good match, solid, and I like the way things are moving forward with that angle. You could take that to a pay-per-view. So the way I felt about it was, do I like this? Not particularly, but I could see the flow of the show being done very well in regards to the tag team, to the women, and then the major push right up to the main event. So I think it was kind of ranked in a way that, okay, this is the hierarchy. And unfortunately, you know, for the others, the ratings are showing that people liked the triangle between, Bobby Lashley and Drew McIntyre and Braun Strowman, because people are glued in the last hour and the ratings are reflecting that people liked all three of those matches. And it built up to it where I don't like the name WrestleMania Backlash. I just like the name Backlash, but I felt like in regards to the show, it was tolerable and really interesting if you... And to be honest, a couple drinks to loosen the mood a little bit makes it a lot easier. You know, if you got a couple old fashions in you, I think it makes it a little more tolerable where you're like, okay, maybe I can doze off a little bit in a commercial, wake back up and not be like so darn invested in every single angle and move and thing like that. So I had a couple old fashions, sat down, watched it, and eventually the show ended. And I'm like, okay, Backlash is here. I can't wait to record the podcast and see what's going on. But with WWE, you just can't critique it forever. You just got to take it for what it is. And when you grade it against itself, it makes it a little more tolerable. When you grade it against what it should be, you're going to hate it. So when you just grade it against itself, it was a B-minus show.
But see, that I think is where the big issue is for me, at least, right? Like, you're talking about how you have to self-medicate to watch this program. We should, like, you remember when you were a kid? You would watch this, like, you wouldn't miss it. There was no way you were, like, I would go to my grandmother's house because we couldn't afford cable as a child. And my grandma had USA Network because she had Comcast cable. And I would sit on her couch and I would watch wrestling. And my mom would be like, okay, we got to go home. I'm like, no, no, no. One more match. One more match. Monday Night Raw, I'm like, can it just please be over? How much longer do I have? I'm looking at the clock. Like, I find myself watching my watch more than I watch the actual programming. I think that's an indictment on where we're at with it and what they're giving to us. And it's frustrating. All that being said, I think SmackDown was much better. I think the monster angle that you have going on with SmackDown right now is so much more intriguing, so much more interesting. And I feel like it pulls you in. The fact that they brought Jimmy Uso back and now have mixed him in with Roman Reigns and Jey Uso, and Jimmy's kind of like the odd man out here, and he's like, no, I'm not gonna listen to you. I'm not gonna be your bitch. I'm not like Jey. I'm my own man. I'm gonna do my own thing. And you kind of feel like Roman Reigns is almost trying to force his hand. And I think we all feel like when push comes to shove, Jimmy Uso is going to join Roman Reigns and Jey Uso. And I feel like it would be a silly thing to do for WWE to break up Jimmy and Jey, because they are one of the best tag teams in WWE. On top of that, you add Jimmy to what Roman Reigns has already kind of helped establish here. I think it just makes it that much stronger. And I think Jimmy himself, I think, is fantastic. I think Jey is a very good wrestler. I think out of the two, and it's only by a small margin, I think Jimmy is the better individual, whether it be on the microphone or whether it be in the ring. And I think if you pull him away from the mix, I think it weakens it. But if you add him to the mix, it makes it that much stronger. And I love the addition and the new wrinkle of Jimmy kind of being on the outside looking in and trying not to get pulled in. What did you make of the addition of Jimmy last week, but also the follow-up this week where he's challenging Cesaro, trying to prove that he can beat Cesaro where Roman Reigns can't?
I just like to see that, you know, potentially Jimmy's getting under the skin of Roman Reigns. You see a good dynamic forming there, and you're building intrigue. And I think that, you know, for me, I know a lot of people online didn't like it, but I found humor in the Medal of Honor ceremony. I liked, you know, I'm liking Apollo Crews and Commander Aziz. It's like so dumb, but it's like funny. And, you know, I found it to be one of the moments I liked the best, obviously outside of the women's tag team. I thought it was good. Like you said, SmackDown was good. Rey Mysterio and Dolph Ziggler did a good job. Rey Mysterio went over. It's good to see him getting some wins. For me, the problem in lies for me was I want to like Bayley and Bianca Belair, but it's not happening. It's just like, I'm not liking this version of Bayley. It just seems like too annoying. I don't know how to describe it. It's just Bianca Belair just seems like she should be in there with the likes of the big time women, Sasha Banks and the likes of the biggest, Charlotte, Rhea Ripley. It just seems like Bayley is just a throwback to something that was. So I'm not liking it. The worst match for me was Corbin and Nakamura. Graded that a D. I just, it harkened back to the feud back like 5 years ago. And you're like, Jesus. But, you know, it wasn't where it needed to be. But you had the main event, and everyone's going to love the opportunity to see Cesaro and Jimmy Uso facing off. So for me, it was a B-plus show. I enjoyed it. It was quick-paced. And obviously, you know, now being that I've been in the Thunderdome so much, and you get to see how many commercials they have, every half hour has like 10 minutes of commercials and 3.5 minutes. And then they break it down into two segments, 3.5 minute commercials and 2.5 minutes. And that's a long time, man. And so I think if they could maybe make the smallest adjustment where you have like 1 5-minute commercial and then you just go, because sometimes the breaks come at the wrong time and you realize that's a long time for an attention span to be like, okay, come back in 3.5 minutes. I'm like, and looking at it like that. But for a 2-hour show, yeah, SmackDown lived up to the billing, got me excited for Sunday's pay-per-view.
So you touched on something real quick, and you mentioned the new tag team women's champions that we have. What did you make of all of that? Did you feel like it was time?
Perfect.
Did you like that it was Natalya and Tamina who get a little bit of love finally?
Yeah, Shayna Baszler needs to go on her own. Nia Jax needs to just kind of be in the opener. You know, it just absolutely perfect. It was well deserved. You could see the emotion. And I think now at this point in time in Natalya's career, any recognition she gets, I think she values and she treasures. And Tamina has really benefited, and this is the value of having a woman like Natalya, who's not out there flashing her leg. She's actually making wrestlers. We care about Tamina more now than we ever did. Why?
No, you're absolutely right.
Because you have Natalya there in her ear. You can see it. It's pretty much straightforward. She's in her ear. The psychology is better. The matches are better. And she has now risen to the level of being worthy of being a tag team champion. Now, put these women on every single Friday and let them work for the next 6 months. And let's not worry about the tag team division as much and build up some new teams that make it fun for these pay-per-views.
You know what's unfortunate is you have somebody like Natalya, right? But Natalya doesn't look like an Eva Marie, or Natalya doesn't look like a Sasha Banks or a Bianca Belair. Natalya looks like she's every girl next door.
But she's got more credit. She's got more credibility than all of them in her pinky finger.
She does. And she understands how the business works, and she understands how to make great matches. Yes. And it's unfortunate for her to be in a spot where she has to be a player coach all the damn time. And she doesn't necessarily get that recognition. And finally she does. And you're right. You could see the emotion. Something else that I took out of SmackDown. And I'm wondering if you're on the same page as me. Cesaro all of a sudden feels like a really big deal.
For sure.
The way that SmackDown closed with him just taking out everybody, taking out Roman Reigns, Jimmy and Jey Uso, calling out Roman Reigns, being like, this is your cousin, do something, as he just continues to do move after move to him. On top of it, he calls him out and he's like, he's not your bitch, you're his bitch. Like just him having a mouthpiece and him being able to go out there and perform like we all know that he can perform and being given the time makes him feel like such a big deal. Makes him feel like he's a credible challenger to Roman Reigns right now. And I haven't had that in a long time. And this is something that's nice to see. WWE has the ability to still make stars. They just don't do it often enough. And in a very short amount of time, Cesaro to me feels very credible and feels, and I don't believe he will take down Roman Reigns, but feels like he could. If they wanted to go in that direction. I don't think they do, so I don't think he will.
And
but
it's obvious he's got an ally, and the ally is Paul Heyman. And when you have an ally, you get the push. And unfortunately, you know, as many people in NFL have dissected Tim Tebow playing tight end, sometimes bottom line, despite all the work you do, despite all the matches that you have, despite being a tag team legend with the bar, despite all the fun, the gimmicks, everything that he's done, despite a 20-year career, sometimes you just need that voice going, hey, let's put him in the show and he'll do fine. And you obviously see it now that Paul Heyman's like, hey, this guy is legit. Let's do something. And the fans like it. The buildup has been fine. And finally, yeah, you know, why not pull the trigger, make him a champ? Even if you make him a champ for a month and you let Roman Reigns get it back at SummerSlam, at least Cesaro has a feel of a guy that when he puts on a suit with the belt, he'll look cool. And I think that he's over, and let's see where it goes from here. But bottom line, he's firmly ingrained as a WWE superstar. He's a legend, and he's got probably a nice 4 to 5 year run ahead of him that should be really solid.
I agree with you 110%. Let's switch gears. Let's go over to NXT. NXT, I thought, was a really good show. To me, the biggest storyline coming out of NXT, Finn Balor comes back and instantly challenges Karrion Kross. And Karrion Kross basically moves him right to the head of the line. And to me, it seems almost like they're rushing this program between the two. Like, we don't necessarily have anything else. And these are the two biggest names we've got in NXT. So let's throw them together and let's get something good out of it instead of something that I think both of us really enjoy. We usually enjoy a good long build. You just had Finn Balor drop the title to Karrion Kross. There's no need for Finn Balor to come back day one and be moved right to the head of the line. I feel like Finn Balor could try to play some mind games with Karrion Kross. They could try to do something a little bit more interesting instead of these guys getting into a ring in the next couple weeks and just dusting it up. To me, it felt way too rushed, and I didn't really like it. Do you agree with me, or do you like that these are the two biggest names in NXT right now, and they should be squaring off?
They should be. I firmly was impressed because if you notice too, as I was in my drinking haze on Raw, all of a sudden, there's Scarlett Bordeaux and Karrion Kross cutting a promo, and I'm like, wow! I was thoroughly impressed. It was one of the best moments and segments of the show. You're like, dude, they got it cut perfectly. He looks like a destroyer, and he just said, set the scene. Here we go. We're going to find out who's next. And if it's Finn Balor, he's the best. It gives you a little bit more time to build up somebody else. And I think it's perfect because, you know, Finn Balor has the credibility where you take the title off of him and then you beat him. I think that also can elevate Karrion Kross to the next level. And absolutely, I'm okay with it. I thought that the feud, I believe the feud still has more life to it.
All right. Let's get your reaction to what took place on Impact this week. What'd you like? What didn't you like? What needed to be better? What was great?
Impact was very solid. You're now getting Matt Stryker and D'Lo Brown on commentary Thursday nights. It's absolutely a good move for Impact to be on this night. Makes it a little harder because you're watching wrestling every single night. And now, too, you have the Dark Side of the Ring returning, which is just simply amazing. And I'll recap the first couple next week. Really amazing inside look at some of the seedy side of professional wrestling. But I enjoyed the first match. It was a number one contenders match for the Knockout Championship. Rosemary with Crazy Steve and Black Taurus took on Havoc, and Havoc gets over. And, you know, Deanna immediately runs in to build up the feud, and it's going to be good to see this feud pay off. I really do believe that Havoc and Deanna Purrazzo could do some damage. I think it could be a match with a nice payoff. Match two, you get an X Division scramble. A lot of nice wrestlers there. Petey Williams, Ace Austin, AC Romero, taking on alongside El Fantasmo, TJP, and Rohit Raju, with El Fantasmo taking down the victory and getting over. Liked it. Good match. Third match, Sam Beal versus Willie Mack. Obviously, you know, Mack hits, you know, the big-time lariats, pop-up forearm, and he hits his top rope splash for the 1-2-3. Willie Mack, Willie Mack is someone that also kind of has that feel of like a guy that you can immediately, you know, really put some effort into and really get over. And then you see Will Morrissey comes in and he takes him down, and everything's going on with the return of the big man. The former ex-WWE star is going to have now a feud with Willie Mack. Ooh, it's going to be good. Always enjoy Carl Anderson with the Elite taking on David Finlay. But David Finlay gets over in this one. And then you get, mid-card, very solid. The main event saw Moose, Sami Callihan, and Chris Bay taking on Matt Cardona, Trey Miguel, and Chris Sabin. Very, very solid match. Sami Callihan, Moose, and Chris Bay get the victory, and all of a sudden we get a chance to see Don Callis watching very closely in the background. What does this mean? Does he have an eye, potentially, on someone new that was victorious? We don't know, but it leaves you with a cliffhanger, which is suspenseful, all that you can ask for from Impact. So it was a B-plus show, very enjoyable. I like the way the pace was set up this time in terms of getting people interested with the women in the X Division. You get some action, you get some intrigue, and then you bring the guns. And you know, the addition of some new talent, you know, after the big pay-per-view is always good for Impact. And now we just got to wait till June, July, when a new infusion of talent comes in. We get new storylines. Oh, baby, just enjoy Impact. It is a very solid show, building up. A little bit of wrinkles in terms of production and things like that, but they're bringing in talent, which allows for new storylines and a great show for Impact Wrestling on Thursday. Good for D'Lo Brown, and good for the announce crew there doing a good job. So they're holding their own, man. I'm excited to see what they're going to do moving forward. Hit me up, cuz. What'd you think of AEW? Because there was a lot going on there as well.
So with AEW, I thought AEW did a fantastic job this week. We're roughly, what, I think 2 weeks out from Double or Nothing, which is one of their biggest pay-per-views that they have. And what I think AEW does better than just about anybody in the business is they give you go-home shows to the go-home show to the go-home show. Like, they are laying bricks, right? And they've been doing it all. They've been doing it for a while. But what they do is right before you get to your big pay-per-view, they start giving you what should be a go-home show for anybody else in the business, but it's to get you coming back next week so they can actually give you a go-home show to actually get you back the week prior to the pay-per-view to give you the real go-home show. I thought that they did a fantastic job building storylines and building story arcs and really helping flesh everything out. Like, the bones were already there. They this week slapped on all the muscle and they were slapping on tendons. And then next week they're going to slap the skin on it. And then the week after that, they're going to put the lipstick on the pig and then they're going to shove it down our throat with Double or Nothing. I think they do a great job of building intrigue for their big stories. And I think they do a fantastic job with it. And I thought this week was no different. And I think one of the biggest storylines going on right now is the Pinnacle versus the Inner Circle. All right, we had a fantastic – I thought it was great. I thought their Blood and Guts match was absolutely incredible last week. And Blood and Guts, obviously, a gigantic takeoff of War Games. And if anybody tells you any different, they're either snorting something or they're smoking something. All right? But what you ended up getting was what I thought a bloody, gruesome, fun, interesting match. As it was unfolding, I was like, man, this is really, really good stuff. And it was way over the top, and it pissed a lot of people off, but I loved it. I thought the ending was great with Jericho falling off, getting thrown off the top of the structure. But to me, it seems like, again, rushing a storyline, right? Like, I feel like the Pinnacle needs a little bit of time to breathe. You just had this massive match over the Inner Circle. There's no reason to come back and try to cram another one of these awesome matches into a hole here. Let the Pinnacle breathe a little bit. Let them strut. Let them be the cock of the walk a little bit. And then have the Inner Circle come back bigger, better, badder than ever and challenge them. We've got Inner Circle versus the Pinnacle 2 coming up at Double or Nothing. And I'm excited for it, but I feel like it's a little bit too early. Do you think it's too soon, or is this the right time to get another one of these big monster matches?
See, the problem is this would have been a time to move forward because of the fact that does the Inner Circle need to get over to be more credible? Do they need to, you know, lose again to have the Pinnacle be over? I think the Pinnacle should have just took the feud and ran with it and moved on to something else, bigger and better goals. To go back kind of lends to maybe the idea of 50-50 booking, but bottom line, it's going to be great, and maybe you have... You know, if you want to build intrigue, you have an ultimate betrayal. Hell, the Pinnacle. Why not just have Chris Jericho turn on the Inner Circle and destroy it and join up with the Pinnacle? I think that would be great, you know, to have Blanchard right behind Chris Jericho. Or, you know, you have somebody else, you know, one of the big guys. The big guy, you know, moves over to the Pinnacle. I think that's probably where the intrigue comes in. Or... You know, you could go the other way, and the Inner Circle gets over by pinching somebody from the Pinnacle who believes that he's being held down. So if you get a little bit of that fluctuation in who's in what group, then you could potentially have something there to build the intrigue again. But, hey, I'm interested to see it. I can't wait to see the pay-per-view. For me now, though, the part that was the most disappointing was I'm used to Cody delivering an A-plus promo. And it felt like you got a C+, and he was rambling, and then he started bringing politics into it, and he's like, y'all need to be real Americans. And you're like, okay. And you feel like...
I was waiting for them to hit Hulk Hogan's music.
Yeah.
I am a real American.
Exactly. And you're like, oh, this is how you're going to bring back American Dream? Shit, you should just play the music. You know, you should have did the dance. You should have found a relative of... Dusty Rhodes' ex-manager, and it didn't hit. It was that one. You're like, maybe giving him all that airtime led to him rambling and crying and acting a fool. It needed to be tighter, more succinct, and it didn't hit, and I didn't like it. I thought I brought the show down a little bit, but it made the show hit the crescendo when we get the best man winning the TNT championship. And, you know, as much clamoring as people have for, quote unquote, the television title, you feel like, okay, this is what the TNT title does. It establishes the guy as a test run to see who's next. And Miro should be next. And it was a perfect transition. Miro is definitely the right guy to hold the TV, quote unquote, TNT title.
Did you feel like it was a little bit too soon, though?
No, he's like, the guy. He's big. He's a monster. You know, the fun best man gimmick, it was cute. But no, you don't take Miro and make him a secondary guy. He needs a belt. And I think that he's somebody that this belt is perfectly created for in lieu of not having what you call a quote-unquote intercontinental title.
I think it's a fantastic intermediate belt, right? I think it's a great belt. And I think Miro is the guy for it. I just felt like Darby Allin was doing a really good job with the belt. And I'm wondering if he's working through some injuries and maybe he needs a little bit of time off. But I felt like it was a little bit too rushed. Like, you could have got, like, this could have been something that you save for Double or Nothing, right? This could have been one of those moments where you had it set up for your pay-per-view and given everybody the shock on the pay-per-view. And you could have had these guys go back and forth a couple times. You could have had a couple matches where Miro gets disqualified for just going a little bit too hard at Darby and the ref has to save him or whatever. There's different storylines you could spin out of this. Instead, you have Miro basically put Darby to sleep in the middle of the ring and wins the title on TV. And I felt like giving this away was just the wrong time. I felt like you could have saved it for another 2 weeks and given it to everybody at a pay-per-view. And I thought it could have been a little bit better at a pay-per-view. But otherwise, I thought AEW was absolutely fantastic. And if anything else, what you can do here from this, right? Like there's always ways you can spin things. Going into the pay-per-view, you could have Darby Allin and Miro have a fantastic match at the pay-per-view for the TNT Championship. It could be his retribution. It could be his rematch, because I'm sure he has a rematch clause somewhere in his contract. So it'll be interesting to see. Overall, I thought wrestling this week was pretty good.
Yeah.
I thought out of everything, I thought Raw was probably the biggest letdown. But that being said, it sets us up for Backlash, which is going to take place on Sunday. And we're going to kick off our preview here with the WWE Championship. Before we get into that, though, just to kind of reset the score, the Doc and myself are tied 3-3. If you're new to this, basically the way it works is we go through, we make our predictions. Whoever has the most predictions right gets a point. If for some reason we end up tied, we split that point. Every now and then, there'll be like a battle royal or something like that. We will add in an extra bonus point if you're able to get the selection correct. So we're going to kick this off with the WWE Championship match. We've got Bobby Lashley versus Drew McIntyre versus Braun Strowman. Who do you have winning this match?
Man, it's crazy. If WWE wants to make the red brand more enjoyable and maybe up the ratings, booking Strowman to walk out probably is the best, but I think you got to find a way to get Strowman and Lashley at SummerSlam. I think that's the moneymaker. But I still don't think it's time to end the run. I mean, Bobby Lashley steps on the ropes, puts his arms out, looks like a legit champion, and it's time to keep flushing that out. So I think it's Bobby Lashley still the champ.
I'm going to agree with you. I think it's Bobby Lashley as well. Just kind of running through this. I don't feel like Drew McIntyre is as hot as he once was. Braun Strowman, I think at some point, like you said, maybe SummerSlam, that might be the time for Braun Strowman to get the belt. But for right now, it feels like Bobby Lashley is the guy. Now, a match that we spent a lot of time talking about, the Universal Championship, Roman Reigns versus Cesaro. This is probably the match that has me most intrigued out of everything on this card. I would love to see nothing more than Cesaro get the win. I don't think it's going to happen, though. I think what we're going to end up having happen is Cesaro is going to have Roman Reigns basically on the ropes. He's going to just about have him defeated. And I think what you'll see Jimmy Uso get involved. And I think Jimmy Uso will come to Roman Reigns' side and come to his aid and help him out. And because of that, I think Roman Reigns will retain his belt.
Agree. I think if you have a title change for Cesaro, make it bigger at SummerSlam with people. Mm-hmm. What better spot? Because you're hearing whispers that maybe SummerSlam will involve some paid people in attendance that will be there. So that would be amazing. Meaning not they're paying people, meaning that people will actually dole out some money for some ducats. Maybe again, 25,000 or so. And hopefully we get back to some touring audiences and things like that. So what better place for Cesaro than SummerSlam? I think we have two championships that are retained.
Let's move on to the SmackDown Women's Championship. We've got Bianca Belair defending against Bayley. at no point do I feel like Bayley is a threat right now. I think Bianca Belair is probably the best woman on SmackDown, and that even includes Sasha Banks. So I don't see why you would take the title off her and put it on Bayley. Until Becky Lynch returns, I'm not sure if there is another woman that I want holding a belt other than Bianca Belair.
Just so I'm gonna the go lock Bianca of the Belair night. Yeah, this. The lock of the night. Absolutely, Bianca Belair.
All right, let's move on to the Raw Women's Championship. We've got Rhea Ripley defending against Asuka, defending against Charlotte. Does this not feel like this is handpicked and handmade for Charlotte to walk out the Women's Raw Champion? Who do you have winning this?
I hope you pitch. I hope you select Charlotte because you give me the title right away. No way, it's Rhea Ripley. I think what you do is you build up for SummerSlam Rhea and Charlotte again by having Rhea take out Asuka. And you have Charlotte being ever so close again, but you just dump on Asuka and have Rhea destroy her and get the W. So no way. You would not – there's no reason, logically, ratings-wise, or anything, to take the title off of Rhea at this point. You would, in essence, chop out her career right from under her by taking it out in less
but
than a month.
But they've done it to her before. They did it to her. They did it to her when she was in, in NXT.
I'm calling Rhea Ripley, man. There's no way. I don't see it. I would be shocked, and it would be one of those moments where you would feel ultimate disappointment, and then you go to social media to see who's canceling who's canceling the cock as a result of Rhea losing.
I'm going to go Rhea Ripley as well because it just makes sense, right? But don't be surprised if Charlotte ends up walking out with the title. Yeah. That's all I'm telling you. Don't be surprised.
And then memo to her stylist, just stop with the shorts and the exposing of her ankles. Just robes and wrestling gear because this new look just highlights the work that she's done on her face.
How much work has she had done? See, she looks like a totally different person.
My wife said it perfectly. She's like, she doesn't look good. You got to highlight the stuff, the dazzle, the stuff. Stop with the dresses and the made up like businesswoman attire because that just highlights your face and it's done the work. You know, highlight the wrestling and the gear. Charlotte doesn't need to be posing on her Instagram all the vacation stuff and doing that. She's Charlotte Flair. It's not working. So just stop with the wardrobe and the coming down to the ring and commentating. We don't need to see it. Just wrestle, be a heel, talk shit, and leave the arena. So that's my rant for the week.
I like your rant. SmackDown Tag Team Championship. We've got Dolph Ziggler, Robert Roode versus Dominik and Rey Mysterio. I think Dominik and Rey are going to get a nice little push here. I've got them winning this.
Absolutely.
Who do you think?
Yeah, because Dolph and Robert aren't bringing the heat. It'd be a nice story because they've done a good job with dropping the seeds on SmackDown, where I don't believe a father-son have ever held the title, and that would be really cool to see. So Dominik and Rey Mysterio obviously would handle business very well.
Yeah, I think it'll be a nice day for both of those guys. Now, Damian Priest versus The Miz. This is a lumberjack match. This is a match that Damian Priest ended up hand selecting after beating John Morrison. I think Damian Priest comes out the winner in this. It's his match. He picked it. The Miz helped make a star with Bad Bunny at WrestleMania. I think he's going to help make a star here with Damian Priest. So I'm going to go Damian Priest in this match.
Okay, this might be the one. I gotta think this through, okay? You had Damian Priest win at WrestleMania. You've had Damian Priest defeat John Morrison every single week. Drip Drip is getting his ass handed to him. Now you have The Miz seemingly at all odds. It's a perfect opportunity to elevate The Miz over Damian Priest because you're not going to lose anything because the character is over. So there's going to be some shady business going on. One of the lumberjacks is going to potentially turn on Damian Priest that will piss him off and then send him to the next feud. I think you can't because you have something in The Miz. You have something valuable. To have him go from the champ to losing at Mania to losing at WrestleMania Backlash, it's the height of disrespect, and I don't think it tells the story the way in which The Miz operates. It's operating perfectly in that everyone believes Damian Priest is going to go over. It's his match. It's his thing, but it's too soon. Miz needs to get over. Otherwise, you're going to have him have really no credibility, unless it's a 10-star match. But I believe, truly, The Miz needs to cheat his way to get the W. Otherwise, you lose his ability to talk shit. You have no purpose there. Unless you then officially end The Miz and Johnny Drip Drip to carry it over into SummerSlam, which you're kind of seeing the cracks there. I need to see the Miz win. So I feel like the writing's on the wall, so I'm taking the Miz.
I like your layout for a story, and I think it would be great. The problem is I don't think WWE thinks that far ahead, and yeah, I don't right, think they right. do that good of a job
Miz,
building their
Miz.
Stories.
I want to just cheer for the Miz.
So we've got two matches here that I'm not sure are going to take place, but we're going to put them in here.
Yeah.
And we're going to take a chance here. So we've got the Intercontinental Championship. We've got Apollo Crews versus Big E, which is probably what the match will be. Now, this past week, Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens both got involved in this. So I could see us having a fatal four-way. So for the Intercontinental Championship, I'm going to allow you to pick from four wrestlers who could possibly come away the champion. And if you get one of them right, awesome. If you get one of them wrong, who the hell knows if this match is even going to take place? Right. Not 100% sure.
Apollo has to have it. You don't have a ceremony and then have him lose the title. Aziz is going to have an influence. Apollo walks in, walks out, IC champ.
I'm going to go Apollo Crews as well. Again, I think Sami Zayn, Kevin Owens, they're going to spin that off into Kevin Owens, Sami Zayn episode 942. Nobody really cares. Big E, I feel like he is primed for something bigger. I'm just not sure what it is yet. I don't know what they're doing with him. He was supposed to get a push. I'm waiting on that push. I think Apollo Crews needs this. So I think Apollo Crews retains his belt. All right. So United States Championship. Now, Humberto Carrillo was supposed to get a nice push this past Monday on Raw. Got a little banged up. We're going to talk about it a little bit in the news and notes. Sheamus is obviously the champion. It was their match. They both left pretty banged up from this match. I don't know if Humberto is going to be in shape for this match, but if it does take place, Sheamus or Humberto, who do you think wins this?
Sheamus, baby. It's got to be Sheamus and Cesaro. Taking shape and doing some things. So I'm all aboard the Sheamus train. I don't think he loses it yet. You got to feature him at SummerSlam. He's the man.
I got Humberto winning this. Like I said, he's poised for a monster push, and I think this is a good way to kick it off. I think you get Humberto the United States Championship, and when SummerSlam comes around, you could have Sheamus take it back from him. I don't know if this is going to take place, but if it does, it could be a really, really interesting match. They were doing a really good job until Humberto got hurt and Sheamus took an awkward bump on Monday night. So we'll see what happens. Real quick to recount everything, we both have Bobby Lashley retaining. We both have Roman Reigns retaining. We both have Bianca Belair retaining. We both have Rhea Ripley retaining. We both have Dominic and Rey Mysterio winning the SmackDown Tag Team Champions. I've got Damian Priest, and you've got The Miz winning in that Lumberjack match. We both have Apollo Crews if that match takes place. And then you've got Sheamus, and I've got Humberto Carrillo winning in the United States Championship match.
Oh, yeah, I'm winning. This is great. I'm going to hold the title. I'm going to win. It's going to be great. The Doc is poised to take over the championship. I'm loving it. Thank you, cuz, for dropping the easy victory for the DOC. Thank you. Doc is very, very happy. So hit me with this week's professional wrestling news and notes. Tell me what you got. I know it's a lot.
All right, we just talked about Sheamus and Humberto Carrillo. So according to Mike Johnson, Carrillo is okay, even though his match was stopped against Sheamus on Monday. Carrillo attempted a sunset flip with Sheamus, and they both hit hard on the outside of the ring. It looked like Carrillo maybe hurt his tailbone or maybe his right butt cheek. While Sheamus took an awkward bump, it looks like he landed hard on Carrillo's knees. You could instantly tell that there was something amiss here, but it sounds like he's okay. Don't know if he's going to be medically cleared for this Sunday, though. It's also being reported that AEW star and Team Taz member Ricky Starks will be out of action for several months due to a neck injury. Voices of Wrestling are reporting Starks has been diagnosed with a fractured neck and is set to be out of action for 3 months. Fightful Select followed up by confirming it's a slight fracture and he won't require surgery. He's expected to remain on TV in some capacity while he recovers, but won't be competing in the ring for a little while. It's not confirmed where the injury happened, but you'll remember he was taking on Adam Hangman Page, and there was a German suplex spot that took place on the April 21st episode of Dynamite, and it's expected that's where the injury occurred. Now, speaking of injuries, Chris Jericho may be needing some time away from the ring. According to Brian Alvarez of Wrestling Observer Radio, Jericho suffered an injury while falling off the top of the cage following the Blood and Guts match between the Pinnacle and the Inner Circle last week. While Alvarez was unable to confirm, he added that Jericho may have fractured his elbow. Now, there is a challenge for a stadium stampede match that was laid down for Double or Nothing, with the stipulation being that the Inner Circle must disband if they lose. This suggests that Jericho is going to work through the elbow injury, but since it's a stadium stampede match, it's more of a cinematic match. There's a lot of cuts and edits. AEW could find a way to protect him and really help him through this while they try to figure out what they're going to do. Now, Andrade may have a new home soon. Following his release from WWE in March, Andrade is reportedly in contracts talks with AEW. According to Dave Meltzer of Wrestling Observer Newsletter, AEW and Andrade have been negotiating, but he is not sure where they stand. Andrade was granted his release from WWE 2 months ago after having been absent from television for 5 months. The former NXT and United States champion last match was a loss to Angel Garza on Raw in October. Now, Ringside News and Dave Meltzer have both confirmed that WWE is bringing back Zelina Vega. According to the report, the plan is currently to bring her back to the main roster, but it's not known whether that will be as a wrestler or a manager. She previously wanted to wrestle more and manage less. There has been talks of pairing her up with a real-life husband, Aleister Black, who is seemingly set to return to SmackDown very soon. Speaking of Black, he's gotten into some really great shape. If you check out his Instagram or his Twitter, he is down to 196 pounds, and he is lean and cut. He looks fantastic. Now, rumors is what we kind of previewed the show with. Rumors are that there are some big-name difference makers that are hesitant to sign with AEW because of some infighting between some of the EVPs. Sounds like guys are being scared off because of differences between Cody Rhodes and the Elite. This was something that we reported a little while ago, something I think was probably almost a year, maybe 2 years ago we reported this, and it seems like it's still continuing on. It doesn't sound like things are moving extremely comfortably. It sounds like there's a little bit of a rocky sail for the guys over at AEW, especially with the EVPs. It doesn't seem to really be hurting the on-screen product. It just seems to be something going on in the back. So hopefully it doesn't spill over to what we see on television, but usually it doesn't always work out that way. Now on some sad news, former ECW star New Jack, Jerome Young, has passed away at the age of 58 after suffering a heart attack. PW Insider reported the news on Friday night. New Jack was considered one of the most controversial performers in wrestling. In his time in Smoky Mountain Wrestling and ECW, he earned him the reputation with his intense promos and his violent matches. His run in ECW as both a tag team performer and a singles performer would be considered by most the peak of his career. He teamed with Mustafa as the Gangsters, where they became ECW World Tag Team Champions. He also gained a reputation for dangerous stunts and made a habit out of diving off of balconies during his matches. He was also a bit of a hothead and a bit of a danger to some of his in-ring competition, most notably his match against Mass Transit, who was a 17-year-old kid that he ended up blading, and he bladed him way too deep, and the kid almost bled out and died, and Gypsy Joe, where he took a set of scissors and stabbed Joe in a bingo hall. New Jack was one of my favorites. It's a sad day that he died. He was absolutely batshit crazy, though. Like, there was something not right about him. And that's going to do it for this week's wrestling news and notes, my man.
Another great podcast, man. 181 in the books. Great pay-per-view ahead. Hopefully, it turns out to be entertaining and well worth our time. Make sure you follow the network at Detroit Podcast. All you got to do is go to your favorite place that you listen to podcasts anywhere. Spotify, TuneIn Radio, the big places, Apple Podcasts, DetroitSportsPodcast.com. Anywhere that you love finding podcasts, make sure you just type in three words, Detroit Sports Podcast, and you can find our daily content where we talk about all things in regards to Detroit sports, Michigan athletics, gambling, wrestling, all things that are entertaining and fun. We definitely hit on, especially on the Doc and Jock program, which airs every single Thursday, the flagship podcast on our network. Make sure you follow Adam on Twitter at AdamRSTROZ. We'll be tweeting during the pay-per-view. I hope everyone gets a chance to enjoy it. I think it'll be a good one. And make sure you stay tuned next week for the next episode of the Doc and Jock Wrestling Podcast. Thanks, guys.